So this is our fifth meetup. So we do these meetups every 3 months or so. Actually, we started off doing them in person, but that's really difficult in this in the current environment. So hence they are online. Maybe they'll stay online. We'll see how that evolves. But the goal is of the meetup just to give some updates about what we're working on. And somebody's joining us. So I hope. Yeah. So that's the that's what the meetup is about. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about the problem that Weave8 aims to solve. I'm going to give you a few demo queries. So we have a demo data set that I want to show you that you can see it. I want to say a few words how Weave8 works under the hood for those who don't know this. And then I want to show a quick getting started demo. So let's first look at the problem that we're dealing with. So there are many search engines around, and there are many great search engines around. So the question is, like, why would we add something to that stack? And that problem, oh, more people joining. Yeah. So this mostly has to do with the fact that 80% of data is still unstructured text. That's a source that we got from Forbes. And the problem that you have with unstructured text is if you want to classify data. So, for example, if you might have an invoice with certain items on it, and you want to actually classify what type of invoice it is. So, for example, if there's pens that you want to say it as, you know, office supplies, then that's still actually difficult to do because you need to match on keywords, or you need to do some fuzzy matching. But it's relatively difficult to do this. And the same goes actually in the reverse order. That's if you actually want to search through unstructured text. This problem is, of course, being solved right now. So if we see that if you look at search, the status quo search engines often get enhanced with machine learning capabilities, or that this is done through a manual effort in searching. And with classification, that is often done by data scientists labeling the data and those kind of things, or it's also a manual effort to fit data in the right boxes. And with the machine learning capabilities, it's not really scalable, and it's labor intensive. What I mean with that is that what you often see with existing search engines is that the search engine returns a traditional result, and that there's then a machine learning wrapper around those results that organizes the results and presents them to the end user. The problem with that is that it's still difficult to find something in large data sets. If you look at data scientists, it's labeling data. That's not only expensive, that's of course also something that they probably don't want to do, because you want to work on models, you want to create results, and you don't want to be, you know, busy labeling data, let alone the manual effort of actually organizing data, structuring data, adding labels, adding meta tags, and those kind of things. So that's where Weave8 comes in and what Weave8 aims to solve. So Weave8 is a vector search engine. What that means is that it has built-in machine learning models to index data. So the demo that I will show you in a bit, for those who are new, they will see that actually when the data gets indexed, we can search through it based on the vector representations that it has. So we can also find data without using the exact keywords. Weave8 itself is completely API-based. It has a RESTful and a GraphQL API. Weave8 is used, the most use cases that we currently see are automatic classification and semantic search. What I mean with and more is that we also see people, using Weave8 as an actually core infrastructure. So that's really cool. And Weave8 has an open source core. So that means that you can actually find everything on GitHub. So let me start with a demo about the semantic search features. And that is for those new on the call, they haven't seen that. I've demoed that, of course, to others who know Weave8. So if you just Google for Weave8, then the first result that you find is the documentation. And the documentation is on our website, semi.technology. And the documentation is ever-changing. So in my second demo today, you will also see that we've added a lot of things there as well. But I first just want to show you Weave8 in action. And we often say that we use the RESTful API to add data, and the GraphQL API to get data. And then we have three types of getting data. We have get, aggregate. So for aggregate, for example, to say like, you know, how many data objects do I have? And explore means that you want to search through the complete vector space. But I'm going to use get first. On the documentation, you find all these examples, for example, in GraphQL, the equivalents in Python, JavaScript, and curl even as well. But there's also a green, you know, a ball right there. And if you actually click here, you can actually get a use the demo data set that we have online. And a demo data set contains news publications. And that's the easiest way for me to show you the value of abbreviate. So this demo data set contains articles and news articles and publications. So what I can do is that I can say, well, I want to get things, and let's start with publications, and the publications have a name. And then if I run this query, you see all the publications. So Financial Times, New Yorker, Vogue, Wired, Economist, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So to show you the semantic features of abbreviate in action, we have a filter, which you can find through the documentation, well, under filters. You can say, well, I want to explore, and we call that explore because we didn't want to confuse it with traditional querying. So that's why we call it explore. You can say, well, I'm looking for concepts, and then I can say, for example, fashion, and I want to do that with a certainty of 75%. If I now run this query, so give me things which are publications and explore them based on the concept of fashion with a certainty of 75%, then it might return Vogue. And as you can see that here, it does not contain a label, any label related to fashion. Or if I do, for example, finance, and I run this query, and you see the Financial Times and the Economist. So that's how it returns these results. And that does not only go for these short strings, but that also goes actually for text objects. So if you look at the Excel articles themselves, so get things which are articles, and I want to see the title. Let me prettify that. This basically just returns everything, all the articles that are in this demo data set. But here I can do the same thing. So I can say, well, I want to explore, and I want to explore for the concept of, let's say, housing prices in Asia. And let me just say, let's limit that to the first result. So get me things which are articles, explore them based on the concepts of housing prices in Asia. Limit them to the first result and show me the title. So now here you see Prime Property Prediction 2020 Asia and Australia Asia. And what I can also do is that I can say, well, so for example, show me the summary on which this result is based. So here you see in a nutshell how abbreviate works. One more thing that I want to add as well. So this is GraphQL. So abbreviate is also used to store data in a graph structure. So if I want to say, for example, here, if I want to say, yes. No, let's do in publication. It's easier in publication. Then I can say on the publication, show me the name of the publication. So now I'm creating a graph relation where I want to find that housing prices in Asia result. I want to see the title, and I want to see in which publication it is structured. So we can see this is in the Financial Times. So that's in a nutshell for the new people abbreviate in. The strength of abbreviate in action. So I want to say a few things about how that works under the hood for those who are new to this. So abbreviate does not store data in a traditional row column structure or a traditional graph structure, but it actually stores data objects in a vector space, in a hyperspace. And if you start a abbreviate, it comes with a what we call a contextionary, and which is based on are based on word embeddings in a specific language. So in this case, English. All those purple dots represent concepts. So for example, this purple dot might represent publication. This one, fashion. This one, sweater, because then sweater, of course, further away from publication, because there's not really a relation between sweater and publication. Vogue might be somewhere in between. And we do that based on 300-dimensional space. So if I now store this data object that we just found, so we say like we have a publication with the name Vogue, and then we have that has articles, which has a cross-reference. We can also set, for example, geolocations. What abbreviate does on the moment of storing is that it makes an array of the actual language that's in there that we want to index. So in this case, we have a publication with the name folk. It takes those three words, and what it does on import time is that it says, like, it calculates a distance between those words in that space. It weights them based on the importance of the word. How do we say a word is important? Well, we do that based on the original training data set, how often the word occurred. So, for example, you could imagine that the word name occurs way more often than folk. So, therefore, we're going to say the algorithm is going to be biased towards the word folk. And then we have optional things like word boosting, which, for example, users use for abbreviations and those kind of things. Well, what Weaviate does on import time is that it creates a new data object with a new vector representation. And it's actually that vector representation that is stored in that space as you see it here. So what's what you see here is a visualization of a Weaviate with one single data object. So now if we query, as you've seen before my demo, for fashion and for example, haute couture, and it looks in the vicinity and it will actually find that data object. And that's how it knows what to send back. So the next thing that I want to show is a little bit about how you can get started with this. So if you're interested in using it. So that brings me back to the documentation. Where are you? Yes. So if you're in the documentation, you find the installation tab. And there are basically a handful of ways how you can use Weaviate. So the first one is, if you want to run it locally, is through the Docker Compose setup. Something new that we introduced is a configurator, as you see here. So for example, if you want to have a different language, so let's say Italian, you see that the Docker Compose file changes. You can set up modes, you have contextionary models, and of course, there's all the information is under the information button. What you can also do is do a cloud deployment. So we've now launched Weaviate also on a Google Cloud platform. Works basically the same, but then from the perspective of Google Cloud. So you select a project, you can configure it as you just seen, and it runs directly in your Google Cloud environment. We have something in beta now, which is the cluster service. That is this. You can find that if you go on the website. There's at the top, there's a pink button that you can click to log in to the cluster service. What we do is that the first cluster that we create, we call it the Weaviate Sandbox, runs for 2 weeks, and that's just, you know, for free. So if you don't want to go through the hustle of setting it up and just playing around with Weaviate, you can do it like this. You can, let's for now, disable authentication and empty Weaviate in English, and then I create them. Takes about a minute or 3-4 to actually create the instance. So let's do that in the meantime. And last but not least, you have the whole Kubernetes setup. That is something that I won't go in detail in right now because it's just more focusing on Kubernetes rather than on Weaviate. But it's just so you know that we also have all the Helm charts available in case you want to use Kubernetes. Now, the first thing that you always need to do in Weaviate is that you need to create a schema. Because Weaviate is schema-based. However, sometimes we also see that people, if they just want to have a normal search engine, they just create one class in their schema. But you can also create a big graph. So we also see on the other end of the spectrum that people build whole knowledge graphs with Weaviate. Depends a little bit on what you want to do and what your use case is. You can do both. And the easiest way to access Weaviate is actually through the client libraries. Because Weaviate is API-based, you can just directly use the API. So this is, for example, that news article demo data set. So I don't have an example of that API here. So we have to wait till this one is finished. This one is protected that we don't have people destroying our demo data set. But we need to give it a few minutes before this is done. But Weaviate, you can access Weaviate directly to the RESTful API as well. So the first thing that we need to do is create a schema. And as you can see here, so for example, you see the curl example, and that's just, if you want to get a schema, that's just an old-fashioned curl response. But you can do the equivalent with JavaScript and with Python. And to actually show this in action, I'm going to demo it in the Python library. which you just install with pip. So quick demo, quick example. So I can say, well, I want to import Weavy 8 and I'm going to import JSON as well because I want to beautify the results. And then I need to create a client. So I can say, well, the Weavy 8 client that I want to create is Weavy 8. That's client and then the URL. So let's see if we already know what that is. Yes, here it is. So you see it's now done loading. So I can say connect to this Weavy 8. And then if I open the API, you can see it's actually functioning. So let me take this URL. Then one of the things that I can do, simple example to see if it's working, is that I can say, well, if I want to see the schema, I can say, well, client.schema.get. And then I can say print JSON dumps and show me the schema. Of course, this result should return something empty because we haven't created anything in schema yet. So Python demo, here we go. And here you see, right, so we have the action and things, and those are empty. So what we now can do is that we can actually create a class. So I can say class object. Needless to say that this is everything that you can all find in the documentation. So we both have how-to. So here you see how to create a schema, but you can also do it directly from the RESTful schema endpoint where you can say, well, if you want to create a class, I'm just going to type it out for you now. So I can say, well, I have a class, and that class is a document, and it has a description, which I'm just for now going to say test. The description is literally just a description. I can say if I want Weavy 8 to vectorize the class name. So that means, like, do we want when indexing data to include, in this case, the word document? So we can say vectorize class name, and we're going to say for this demo, we're going to say false, because we're going to work really with documents. And then we're going to add the properties. And for this demo, we're going to add two properties. So property is name, one is title. And we're going to have a description here, which I'm just going to copy like this, because we're going to just going to say test there. We need to set a data type. All the data types are on, all the data types are on in the documentation as well. Think about strings, text, but you can also make graph relations in the data types. But for now, for the demo, we're just going to create a string. And then we're going to say vectorize property name, and there we're going to say false as well. So do we want to include the word title in here? So this is a document with property title. No, we don't want that, but we want to actually index, we do want to index the text that we're going to add. And let me add a second property, and that property we're just going to call it a content. So we're going to say content, going to keep the description for test for now. This is not a string, but this is text value. We're going to set the factorization to false, but we can set the indexation to true. So if you now want to add this to Weavy 8, we can say, well, new class is client.schema.create class. Let me see. Did I call this one again? Class object. So here we can create a class. So what we, let's me print new class. Here we go. Let's see if I did that right in one go. Yes, I did. If it returns none, it means there's no error returned. So that means that if I rerun this previous, these two previous lines with the schema, I should actually be able to see that I added the document, which we can see now that now this document is part of Weavy 8. Now, the only thing, so if we now go into, through the console in this case, if you now look at this, if you want to query through this Weavy 8, we will actually be able to see that if you do get things, we prettify that, get things, then here you see now document pops up and document has indeed, what did we give it? Title, and we give it content. Now, obviously, if I run this query, it returns nothing because I didn't add any data yet. So what I want to do is I want to quickly add some data just to show you how simple it is to actually do. So what we can do now, let me uncomment and comment this out. So now I can actually say, well, I have a data object, and I have the title that I want to add, and I have the content that I want to add. And result is just like this, result one, and data one. And then I can say, well, client.data object dot create data one. And I want to create it as a class document. So here you see the class name, and here you see the properties. And I'm going to do that three times because I actually want to show you that for multiple documents. So one, do a little bit easy, but it's just that it's just for demo purposes. And then I'm going to add the last one, number three. And I prepared something that I don't have to copy something. So I have a text here from the Simpsons. A text about the Simpsons. I'm going to add that here. I have something about the first semester in college from this year. It's, of course, about the pandemic. And then I have something about cars, about Ferrari in this case. And some text. So let me quickly see if I did everything correct. Yes. Yeah. So what I would, if I run this this script and it runs successfully, then I see should see three UUIDs that are representing these data objects. So let me run this script. And then I see not what I want to see. Why is that? Maybe I didn't save it correctly. Yes, this is better. So sorry, I didn't save it correctly. So these are those three unique identifiers for those three data objects. So if I now run this query, you will see that it returns these three data objects. Now, last but not least, if I now want to semantically query through them, for example, then I could do that here, of course, but it's more fun to do that directly in Python. So then I can do the following. I can say, well, I want to explore. And let's say that I want to do that based on the concepts of division show and with a certainty of 85%. So I'm going to say I want to explore for the concept television show. It's in plural because we can also do, you can do also television and show. Here it looks at the individual words, and here it looks at the grouping of the words. So we're going to do that both. And then I'm going to say client get, sorry, query, of course, query get things. Then I say I want to look through the document, and then I want to get back the, let's say, how did I call them again? The title, and maybe also the content. Or let's first do the only the title. That's easier to see the results. And I can do with explore. Let's say explore, and then I execute it. And then, of course, I also should say results. So if I now say, show me this result. So again, basically, I'm going to say from those documents that we added, I'm going to say, okay, explore based on the television show with a certainty of 85%, client query get things document title with an explore function. As you might notice, that this is a builder pattern, which is the same here in get things document. You see that here as well, get things document. And then I'm going to print the result. And then I made an error, which I've got a comma. It's a live demo, so then that sometimes happens. So then you see that the first result comes back is the Simpsons six error defining episodes because I searched for television show. And if I now would search for race course as well, then we get back the article about Ferrari. So now you've seen how I, in a few minutes, built an actual document search tool with Weaviate. Again, you could keep going on and on with this. You can add graph connections. You can add different types of data objects. But this is in a nutshell how Weaviate works. Let's see if there's more that I wanted to share with you. Oh, no, that's basically it already. So thank you again for listening. And if you have any questions, then make sure to let me know. Thank you.